When you step up, please state your name and your address for the public record. And then, okay, I'm sorry. And that there's an issue that I've often cautioned people about defaming someone else. Public figures were fair game. Everyone from us on all the way up to the presidency. And, you know, if you're so inclined, I don't know. But your neighbor who annoys you, please don't identify them by name, because they're not public figures, and they're defaming. You run the risk of defaming someone, and you'll be ruled out. So the other thing that I keep forgetting to tell folks is that during this time, this is your time to speak. So the council doesn't speak. In fact, we actually don't allow ourselves to speak to people, so there's not an exchange, but principally it's because it's your opportunity. Clearly, we get to speak lots and lots, maybe too much, perhaps. So, as I said, this is your time. So to start with, on the sign-up sheet, we have Lily Lombard, please.
Hi, I'm Lily Lombard. I live at 39 Monroe Street. I'm here tonight to speak on behalf of the resolutions before you, both the Carbon Pricing Resolution and the Safe Communities Act, both of which I hope that you will show unanimous support for. With regard to the Carbon Pricing Resolution, I just want to hearken back to a comment that Senator Ed Markey made at Town Hall when he came and visited us shortly after the election. He said, when my 15-year-old daughter asked, he said, if we don't solve the climate problem, every other problem is going to be a footnote in history. We have maybe a dozen years to rein in our carbon pollution, or we will hit some major tipping points, such as the collapsing of ice sheets, a massive ocean acidification, and these warming precipitating more warming, such as the thawing of the permafrost, releasing tons and tons of methane. So for all these reasons, carbon pricing is the best solution we have before us. We have to act at the state. We don't have time to kick this can down the road any longer. So we must exert every political tool and pressure that we can on our representatives to let them know that this is a first and foremost problem, that every other problem will be a footnote in history if we don't address it. I would like to invite everyone in this room who supports Carbon Pricing Resolution. They may speak on their own, but those shy among us, to please stand. All right, thank you. And I also ask that you please support the Safe Communities Act, which will protect the citizens in Massachusetts from inappropriate and unlawful invasion of their privacy and their security. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Adele Franks, please.
Thank you. My name is Adele Franks. I live at 123 Black Birch Trail in Florence. And I am here to speak in favor of the two resolutions before you, one being the Safe Communities Act and the other being the one to urge our state legislature to institute a fee on carbon-polluting fossil fuels. Both of these resolutions would encourage our state to do the right thing. Even though our country may be going in the wrong direction, our state has a chance to go in the right direction and establish some leadership. I would like to specifically thank Councilors Klein, Carney, and Bidwell for the way that they worded the carbon pricing resolution, because it focuses on supporting the concept of putting a price on polluting fossil fuels. And we know that there are several bills in the state legislature that have some different details, and I'd just like to point out a couple of those differences. One being Senator Barrett's bill, which puts a fee on all fossil fuels entering Massachusetts, and all the money collected would then be rebated to people in Massachusetts and as well as employers in Massachusetts, which includes municipalities as employers. Whereas another bill in the House, Representative Benson's bill, similarly puts a fee on all carbon fuels coming into the state, but takes 20% of the funds collected as a result and puts it into a green infrastructure fund, which would most of it, 85% of it, which would go back to municipalities to invest in transportation infrastructure and to aid low-income families for in their energy efficiency activities. Nobody knows how these bills are going to fare in the state legislature, which is why I think it's really important to support the general concept of carbon pricing and not get too wound up in the details and not support one bill over another. So I think that this resolution is precisely what we need to lead our state in the right direction, and I hope you will all support it. Thank you.
Laura Santusen.
Hello. I'm Laura Santusen, 32 East Center Street, Leeds. And I'm here on behalf of Citizens Climate Lobby, the new Amherst Northampton chapter. And first of all, I want to thank you for considering the carbon pricing resolution that's before you. Citizens Climate Lobby is a national organization, and it was founded to slow the effects of climate change. It's a data and evidence-based organization, both in the scientific realm, you know, what is causing climate change, and also in the policy realm, what can we possibly do to stop it? So after consulting experts, studies, commissioning our own studies, the group decided that the number one thing that could be done to slow climate change was to enact carbon pricing. Now, we work at the national level, so we are lobbying national legislators. However, this is also a local issue. It's obviously a state issue. We've got the bills before the state. But we went to see Congressman McGovern last Friday, and he said that on his annual farm tour of 13 farms in one day, every single farmer mentioned to him that climate change was negatively affecting their ability to farm, and we are an agricultural community. We also see the effects of Lyme disease, increased Lyme disease locally. We also see our hemlock trees dying, and we also see the very strange weather, you know, the tornado in Conway and other things. So I urge you to consider this as a local issue. And I'd also like to say that your support is very important. Politicians don't just you know, think of these things and enact legislation on their own. They really need support from the people. And there's nothing more people-ish than a local city council. So I urge you to enact this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Catherine Morish.
My name is Catherine Morish, 9 Prospect Heights, Northampton. I'm just going to read a paragraph and then I'll talk a little bit. Hundreds of American cities and towns have passed laws to ban or regulate the use of leaf blowers, particularly gas-powered leaf blowers. Why? In part because of the heavy contribution of gas-powered leaf blowers to air pollution. A single small gas-powered leaf blower creates as much air pollution as 50 full-size sedans. The exhaust from the gas-powered leaf blowers is much higher in nitrous oxide than from automobiles, and unlike the auto exhaust, consists in large part of a fine spray of oils and hydrocarbons. These are inhaled into human and animal lungs. This can cause emphysema, heart attacks, and cancer. And there's a huge amount of cancer in Connecticut because it's the highest amount of gas-powered leaf blowers in the country. Of course, there is the noise pollution problem. A typical gas-powered leaf blower will produce a noise level of 75 decibels at 50 feet and 100 decibels at close range. And often you have two or three going, and then another house, and then a cruncher. And this is what noise is what they use to torture ISIS. This is awful. Isn't it time for us to sort of take another look at this, and it's getting worse every day. I had 8 hours of it the other day. I went away for two, came back for one, then sat in the hotel, no, the Cooley Dickinson waiting room for the other four. And it's getting worse and worse. Also, I'm worried about the exhaust from the cars and the trucks, especially the dump trucks. The fumes coming up. When I had a friend from California, she said, my God, this is the way Los Angeles used to be. We fixed it up the emissions. So I'm hoping we can work on automobile, truck, all those emissions, especially the dump trucks are awful. And I know they're going to get new town trucks, so maybe they'll have better emission control on that. So I want to say one thing. I've had several family members in the last few years, about five of them, in Sloan Kettering and Dana Farber. And I cannot tell you how much comes across to me. Environment helps cause cancer, not just genes. It's getting very bad. I lost my husband to cancer in February. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mary McKittrick, please.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing this opportunity for citizens to speak. I really appreciate it. As you may know, the ACLU has initiated.
I'm sorry, can you get Mary,
Mary McKittrick, sure. 134 Riverside Drive in Florence. Thanks. As you may know, the ACLU has initiated the Freedom Cities campaign, which includes an effort to set up meetings between citizens and their local police departments to request police cooperation in protecting immigrants in our communities by following a 9-point plan detailed on their People Power website. I was among the group that visited Chief Casper on March 23rd, 2017 to discuss the 9 points with her. For the most part, Northampton Police Department is on board with the 9 points, with a few exceptions. Since Northampton is a sanctuary city, I wondered how the NPD's exceptions to the 9 points can be reconciled with sanctuary city status. The main point at issue is Freedom City's point number 3, which reads, unless acting pursuant to a court order or a legitimate law enforcement purpose that is unrelated to the enforcement of a civil immigration law, no city official shall permit ICE or CPB agents access to city facilities or any person in city custody for investigative interviews or other investigative purposes. Chief Casper demurred, saying that NPD is obliged to cooperate with any federal agent seeking access to people in their custody. In the standards section of the text of Senate Bill 1305, known as the Safe Communities Act, standard number 8 states that an interview between a United States Department of Homeland Security agent and a person in the custody of a law enforcement agency conducted for immigration enforcement purposes shall take place only if the person in custody has given consent. I think the Safe Communities Act is perhaps too narrowly focused on interactions between law enforcement and Homeland Security and should be broadened or amended to include any federal agency directed to pursue immigration issues. I would like to see the City of Northampton clarify whether our police department is obligated to cooperate with any federal agencies, immigration and customs enforcement, customs and border patrol, homeland security, FBI, etc., in any request to gain access to persons in custody. Thank you.
Vera, and I'm sorry I can't read your last.
Vern,
I'm sorry. Boy, I'm not even close. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Vern Fath, 134 Riverside Drive. First, I want to thank you for doing a job that is sometimes thankless, sometimes contentious, sometimes tedious, but greatly needed. And I hope you at least find it sometimes rewarding. Our current federal, state, executive branches of government are not leading, or at least not leading in a direction that I hope most of us will agree with and cannot be expected to do so in the future. So if we expect to have a future worth a spit, then we must lead from the base, the bottom, and push them in the direction we want to go. I'm here to put you on the spot, and a little, and push a bit, and I hope I'm preaching to the choir. How many of you buy green energy at home? That goes for everyone here. In this state, we have the option of buying our energy from a source other than National Grid or Eversource. And so you have a choice on whether to buy and support fossil fuel-sourced energy and its infrastructure, like gas pipelines and coal-fired generators, or buy green energy and support more local jobs and sustainability. I read in the paper recently that some businesses recently decided not to build here because of the natural gas moratorium. If more energy were diverted to green sources, then maybe it would free up some gas for those businesses that absolutely need it rather than building more pipelines. You have the position and the responsibility to make those decisions for the city. And I think we have a lot of room for more solar roofs, parking lots, etc., which could also stabilize our city energy expenses. And on another topic, as far as the Safe Cities Act, I want you to consider what our responsibilities are in when we have somebody in custody. What is our liability? If they are damaged, hurt, are we responsible for that? Because if we arrest somebody, put them in custody, and ICE comes in and then takes them, we have some ownership in that. So we need to look into what our legal responsibilities are, our legal liabilities are as well, on these people who are in this situation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Marty Nathan.
As always, thanks a lot. Marty Nathan, 24 Massasoit Street. I'm here to support both the carbon pricing resolution and also the Safe Communities resolution, and to tell you the way in which they actually are linked. Carbon pricing is really the baseline in the struggle against climate change. I mean, we have to build all the other forms of energy and conservation will allow us to cut our emissions and have the society that we want. But we have to recover some of the cost, the externalized cost of carbon that we have not been paying a bit of attention to, and now it's coming back to kick us. I hope that this is a unanimous vote on the carbon pricing resolution. The second thing, though, is supporting the Safe Communities Act. I've done some research, and I am a physician in North Springfield, and I take care specifically of a lot of undocumented immigrants from Mexico and Central America. And as you all know, in the last 3 years, we've had a flood of immigrants, particularly from Guatemala. And what my research showed me was that for the last 3 years, there's been a massive drought in Guatemala that has made worse a fungal infection of the coffee plants that people in Guatemala grow and their livelihoods are based on. So many of, and immigration is a very complicated thing, and why people finally leave is always, you know, there are many things that affect it. But for many of the people that we are seeing in the United States now, they are climate refugees, those who have come in the last 3 years from Central America. So there's a linkage here, and our city has always known itself, prided itself in doing what's right, and so I ask you to do what's right on both issues. Thank you very much.
Renna Pye.
My name is Renna Pye. I live at 60 Crescent Street. I'm a diagnostic radiologist by profession, and I've recently become extremely concerned with climate issues, which have been mounting for all of us for many years, obviously. The first citizen here spoke about the tipping point, and I would like to support carbon pricing. I would also like to support safe communities, but I'm only going to speak about carbon pricing right now. And the concept of the tipping point, which is usually used to talk about when the polar ice cap melts, when we can no longer save the Earth. But in this instance, I want to say I love the language at the end of this resolution. It says, make individuals and corporations accountable for the cost of their actions when they choose to use fossil fuels. Well, actually, in fact, we're really only talking about making them slightly accountable for a very slight portion of the result of using fossil fuels. But that's fine. It's a beginning. And then it finally says, ignite a free market-based clean energy revolution. And that's where I think we can think about the tipping point in a different way. We can say, oh, there could be a tipping point where suddenly it's not really cost-effective to talk about coal, oil, et cetera. You know, and really, we are talking about renewable energy. And I think it's exciting that our town has a chance to be a part of that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sharon Moulton, please.
I'm Sharon Moulton. I live at 48 Evergreen Road, Unit 313 in Leeds. And I'm here to thank you for considering both of these resolutions. And I'm not going to reiterate some of the important points, but I am the Climate Action Now representative to the statewide coalition for putting a price on carbon. And I know that one of the strategies for getting the legislature to act is keeping track of communities that say they're in support. I know that there are 6 to 8 very local towns that have gotten a very similar resolution on their warrant for town meetings that will be happening in May. So I'm really happy that Northampton is gonna do this before. And two people have brought up that it makes sense to that in some very important ways, solving the climate disruption problem has a direct effect on refugees and immigration. And it's not just from Central America. Definitely, it's from the Middle East and from Africa. Some of those worst problems are exacerbated by climate change that's already happening. So I'm in favor of both of the resolutions, and I thank you for considering them.
Thank you very much. Susan Voss, please.
Hi, my name is Susan Voss, and I live at 89 Ridgewood Terrace, and I too want to thank you for considering both of these resolutions. I'm really proud to live in a community where people care about these things, and I'm primarily going to speak about the carbon pricing. I won't repeat what we've already heard. I agree with it, but I guess what I'd like to add is that I teach engineering up at Smith College, and I teach Engineering 100 pretty frequently, and we talk about climate change in that class. So each year I have to read about the latest literature out there on climate change, and what's really striking from this perspective is every time I go read about it, it's happening faster and faster than the scientists had said a year ago. So the IPCC comes out with this huge hundreds and hundreds of pages, and we just read the summary of it, but things are happening much, much more quickly, and it's clear that we can't wait around for the EPA to be fixed. And this people in this state and in this city seem to realize that, and I think we're going to need a lot of different strategies to keep our environment from being disrupted. And this carbon pricing is one that's super important. It's not going to be the only one, but I'm really thrilled with the way it's written and how it looks out for everyone, and I hope you approve it unanimously. Thanks.
Thank you. That's all we have signed up. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak at this time? Okie dokie. Thank you all. Now I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll.
Councillor Bidwell.
Here.
Councillor Carney.
Present.
Councillor Dwight.
Here.
Councillor Klein.
Here.
Councillor LaBarge.
Present.
Councillor Murphy.
Here.
Councillor Nash.
Here.
Councillor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councillor Sheriff.
Here.
Okay. We're all here so that we thereby have a quorum and we can convene. First up, we have recognition and one-minute announcements by councilors. Is there Councilor Farge?
Yes. There's going to be a community forum Wednesday, April 26th at the Northampton Senior Center. And it's going to be an excellent forum. If you come early, you can socialize and enjoy refreshments from 4:30 on. And this is a forum for neighbors, Northampton neighbors. And what we're trying to do is get all wards to come together and help Northampton neighbors. And it's a new organization that they're trying to put in place. So hopefully that if any of the councilors are available that you could attend it. I've got on my websites today to invite people to come to this because they really want to start opening the doors and make this happen in our city of Northampton. Also, two, one more. As you probably...
Do you have the date on that, by the way?
Yeah, April 26th.
Thanks.
Yes. And it's 4:30 till 7 o'clock at night. 4:30 is for socializing. 5 o'clock is when it starts. Okay. I also have, which you probably, a lot of you counselors know, that the Northampton Police are investigating an armed robbery, which occurred in my ward last night about 8:30, 8:40 p.m. At Jim's Variety Store. And this is the first time anything like that has ever happened. And we had a young female clerk who was pregnant when that occurred. And thank God nothing happened, but there was a gun visible and so forth. So there is an investigation going on. And if anybody knows of anything, please notify the Northampton Police Department at 587-1100. And as a counselor, I have received a lot of concerns from residents about this happening.
Anyone else?
Thank you. I'd like to announce that on Tuesday, May 16th at 5:30, the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission will have a public hearing about the question of whether to install two speed bumps on Naugatuck Street. The DPW has recommended the installation of two speed bumps to calm traffic on Naugatuck Street. And the process is we want to get the public in to comment on that before the Transportation and Parking Committee makes a recommendation to the mayor on whether to do that. So it's here in the council chambers on Tuesday, May 16th. The meeting starts at 5. But the hearing on Naugatuck Street starts at 5:30. So feel free to come. If you can't come, please email me if you have comments or a position on that question.
Yes, I have two brief items as well. Many of you may know there's a group of 10 cyclists who are taking off at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, bound for Washington, D.C. over about 10 days of cycling to be there in time for the climate change rally. And they are taking off at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning from the parking lot at WHMP, I believe. And many of us are going to be there to wish them well. Led by Andrea Avazian, Peter Ives has described this as a demonstration of how transportation can be fueled by carbohydrates, not fossil fuels. Which I thought was apt. I hope some of you will join me in well at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. And secondly, I just wanted to read a sentence or two from a letter to the editor in the Gazette on April 14th from Nancy Rexford, who was credited in previous days in the Gazette with having brought historic Northampton back to life, basically. And in her response, she acknowledged the role of many others in doing so, but she went out of her way to say this. I'd like to draw people's attention in particular to the critical role played by the Community Preservation Committee. I was present at many meetings and saw how much care and wisdom they bring to their difficult decisions. The fact that the CPC had faith in historic Northampton, even when we were down, made us even more determined to keep fighting. The Community Preservation Act is not just about preserving physical things, historic buildings, natural spaces, and historic housing. It also preserves the life inside them. When the citizens of Northampton voted to pay a little more in taxes to fund the CPC, they saved not only the physical buildings at historic Northampton, but the entire institution, including the documents and objects left in trust by preceding generations and the work of the living people, artists, historians, and community members who gather there to consider how our past shapes and illumines our present. For that, we should all be grateful. So I just wanted to read that in the record. And thank Nancy Rexford and thank Historic Northampton for all they do. And thank the CPC and the citizens who voted for the CP, for the Community Preservation Act, for making all this possible.
Okay. All right, thank you. Councilor Shara?
I want to announce that coming up this Monday, April 24th, the Northampton Democratic City Committee is holding a platform meeting. That is, anyone is invited, doesn't matter whether you're a resident of Northampton or what your party affiliation is. And that is to hear people's thoughts on what the state party platform should contain for the Democrats. So that's at 7 o'clock at JFK in the cafeteria. Everybody's welcome. Please come and tell us what you think should be added.
Councilor Klein, then Councilor LaBarge.
I wanted to announce something that some people perceive as a very neighborhood thing, but it's much broader than that. The Leeds Civic Association once a year does a cleanup of the woods along the river and the bike path in Leeds. And we've been really struggling with it getting kind of really messed up by people who are doing day camping with, we're finding dirty diapers there and beer cans, and the river is getting really filthy in that area. So this year we're doing it on Earth Day, so Saturday morning at 8:45 you can come to the Leeds post office, pick up your bags, your rubber gloves, go out along the trail alongside the river and do pickup of anything that you find. And you don't have to haul the bags out, somebody comes and picks them up with a truck, but just so that anybody who utilizes that part of the city would be very welcome to come and join the Leeds Civic Association in all the neighborhood in Yankee Hill and what they call Irish Town down on the bottom in Audubon Road. Everybody comes together to do this, and we'd love to have people from outside Leeds join us.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, I have another one. On April 27th from 6 to 8:30 p.m. it's an in-depth conversation with Francis Crow, and I definitely want to attend that. And that is going to be held at the historic Northampton, and reservations are required. So you should get a hold of the Northampton Historic, and book your seats, because the pricing on it goes $25 for general admission, preferred seating is $35. And the proceeds will benefit Historic Northampton and its programs. And everybody knows Francis Crow, and I think this is going to be excellent, and I think it will draw in a good attendance.
Okay. Now, the mayor has some proclamations and some information to share. And actually, Your Honor, if you would tell folks about your budget.
Yeah, actually, I was feeling a little, pressure here. There's a lot of events
exactly.
going on. So I thought I'd make my own event announcement.
Okay, thank you.
Last night, I held the first of three town hall budget meetings, basically inviting the public in to talk about the upcoming FY 2018 budget. That was at the Senior Center last night. I've got two more scheduled for next week. Wednesday at 7 p.m. at the Florence Civic Center in Florence, and then Thursday, April 27th, the next night, 7 p.m. At the Leeds Elementary School Library. So I'm trying to do one in Northampton, in downtown, one in Florence, and one in Leeds. And I just invite any residents who want to come and discuss the budget, give me feedback, input. It would be very much appreciated. So that's my meeting event announcement. I also have the honor of issuing a proclamation next week. is Arbor Day, and this is the sort of final council meeting before that, so I did want to sort of publicly issue our annual proclamation honoring Arbor Day, which is April 29th, 2017. Whereas since 1872, a special day has been set aside for the planting of trees, and whereas the holiday called Arbor Day was first observed with the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska and is now observed throughout the nation and the world. And whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, lower our heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife, and whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products, and whereas trees in our city increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, mitigate climate change, aid in stormwater management, and beautify our community, and whereas in 2016, the city planted 112 new trees and completed its first ever professional public shade tree inventory of 10,000 city trees with an estimated replacement value of $16 million. And whereas integrating urban forestry more significantly into sustainable planning initiatives for Northampton is essential to protecting, promoting, and expanding our city's tree canopy, and now therefore I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby proclaim April 29th, 2017, Arbor Day in the city of Northampton, and I urge all residents to celebrate and support our precious tree canopy for the well-being of this and future generations. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and imprinted the city seal this 29th day of April in the year 2017. So sort of in fitting along with Arbor Day, I thought it would be a great opportunity to provide the council with an update. As many of you know, during the reorganization of city government following the new charter, we made some changes to how we approached managing our shade tree and created a new public shade tree commission, which works with a newly appointed city tree warden. And they've been doing an extensive work since that time. Really incredible work, and it seems like every time I walk by you're having a meeting. Every time I walk by the hearing room, I don't even want to ask how often they meet, but they've been doing a lot of work. And so I thought it would be helpful to have Lily Lombard, who's the chair of the Public Shade Tree Commission, come give you an update on some of the work they've done. And she's also going to tell you about some of the great Arbor Day week-long activities that they have planned. And so I'd like to now turn the floor over to Lily Lombard.
Thank you, David. I got a little teary-eyed there. Trees. Well, and it's so exciting having a big audience of people who I'm guessing are big tree supporters. So you're in for a treat, because this is all really good news. All right, so I am the chair of Northampton's Public Shade Tree Commission. We have been in our new form around for almost exactly 2 years, and we've just gotten a tremendous amount done. And the big news is, for the first time in the history of the city, we have a complete citywide public shade tree inventory. So this is very exciting. This is something we needed to do from the beginning all along, but always were just not getting it done. But we got it done, thanks to a matching grant from the Department of Conservation and Recreation, and thanks to some very generous city investment in this really worthwhile database. So we hired the Davy Resource Group to do a professional tree inventory, and we really have high confidence in their data. They found almost 10,000 public shade trees, as David said, worth $16 million and delivering $1.3 million worth of services every year. Those benefits that the mayor described, including not the unnewsworthy issue of stormwater mitigation, which I read about the complaints in the paper today about the stormwater fee, which, by the way, I don't share. But I will say that for every 5% you increase our canopy, our tree canopy, you reduce our stormwater mitigation needs by 2%. So trees really do a tremendous job in managing stormwater, which we will see an increase need to do. So what else did the inventory find? It found that half our trees are in good to excellent health and half are in fair to poor health. Hence, it identified quite a number of trees that need to be removed, but it also identified 2,000 new planting sites where we have the opportunity to plant new trees. So that's exciting, and that's going to be a big part of our future work. It found that maple trees dominate our tree canopy, but that we've been doing a very aggressive job to correct that that singular species with more diverse plantings in recent years. So we are slowly improving the age and health of our tree canopy by our aggressive plantings. And as the mayor mentioned, we planted over 100 trees last year. That's down. That's up from an average of 30 trees per year for the previous many years. And this year we have the goal of planting 250 trees. So that's quite a jump in terms of work we're getting done. So in sum, the inventory really. It showed that we have pretty much a human lifetime worth of deferred attention to trees. That for pretty much since the advent of the automobile culture, we have deprioritized the street tree and not given it its a due place in our city budget. But I'm very pleased to say that with the mayor just appointing a tree warden, first of all, getting a solid tree commission underway, and quadrupling the budget, which is still very modest, of tree planting in our city, we're able to get so much done. Like I said, this year we will plant 250 trees, but we're doing so much more. So let me just tell you a little bit about the tree commission. So it's a seven-person advisory board. We work closely with the tree warden. He attends every meeting. And we meet twice monthly, so as often as you all do, on the first and third Wednesday at 4 p.m. in the hearing room. And we have long to-do lists in between. Our commission is comprised of an arborist, a horticulturalist, an urban planner, two conservation biologists, a seasoned grant writer, and a volunteer organizer. So a really crackajack team, if you ask me. At our meetings, we very frequently invite guests such as experts, stakeholders, and department heads, just so we can be forming connections and working in collaboration with groups. We also have a new citizen group in Northampton called Tree Northampton that is kind of a friends of public shade trees, and they are on our agenda every time we meet. Their main role is to provide us a pipeline of volunteers to help us plant, water, mulch trees. Let's see, what else can I tell you? We have, in addition to the increased planting, we have updated our preferred tree species list in light of threats of disease and climate change. So that's a list that the planning department can now give out to developers that is more appropriate and removes some tree species that should no longer be on the list, like ash because of the emerald ash borer, which has not yet attacked Northampton but is right at our borders. We had a Survey Monkey survey and had 400 responses, and basically the common theme among citizens was we want more trees, we want more shade on more streets. And it also identified 100 people who were interested in volunteering and donating money in support of trees. And then finally, we've done a lot of outreach in Arbor Day 2016. Last year, we worked with all three elementary schools to teach kids about the benefits of trees, and they planted trees on their own school grounds. So that was really exciting. Finally, this is a little bit more wonky, but I think it's really important. We had a special meeting with the mayor and the city planner Wayne Fiden, in which we advocated that street trees be considered core infrastructure in street design and redesign, and that Northampton's tree warden, in consultation with the tree commission, be given a place at the table in the earliest possible stages of street planning and design. So it's not just about, you know, shovels in the ground planting trees, but really being thoughtful about how we plan this infrastructure into our street designs. And I felt that we were very well received. A representative of the Tree Commission now sits on the Bike Ped Subcommittee of the Transportation and Parking Commission. We also had the opportunity to meet directly with ALTA, the consulting group that was hired to create the walk bike planning process, planning document. I would say that direct communication has enhanced greatly between the planning department and our tree warden, so that when during in the site approval process, street trees are identified that might be affected by them, and the tree warden is brought in as a consultant to give advice around that. So these are all really thoughtful, broader ways of managing trees that already are in the ground, which really are our best investments. What's coming up? What's coming up is both Earth Day on Saturday and Arbor Day, which are very close to each other. And actually, because Arbor Day this year falls very close to the People's Climate March in Washington, D.C., so many of us on the commission are going to that march that we decided to hold some of the Arbor Day events on Earth Day. So on Saturday, students from Northampton High School will be helping the tree warden and some commissioners plant trees downtown at the corner of Bridge Street and Holly. And it's wonderful to see, again, young involvement in tree care. I also wrote a guest column for the Gazette, which will appear around Arbor Day, and basically shouting out a little bit like I am now about how far we've come in 2 years. And then we are also, on Arbor Day itself, giving away 500 free tree whips, as we do every year right in front of City Hall. Arbor Day is Friday the 28th, and we'll be giving them away all day on Friday and the morning of Saturday the 29th. So if anyone out there in TV land wants a free tree, we have many to offer. They're tiny little things, but they grow very fast. Let's see, what else? We are slowly shifting from reactive planting and management of trees to proactive management. So this year we are almost exclusively focusing on the South Street Gateway for tree planting. South Street, as you know, is a major corridor coming into the city. There's heavy pedestrian and car traffic along that street, and trees and cars and pedestrians don't mix very well. So a buffer of trees is a great way of both calming traffic and making it a more pleasant way to walk into town. So that is going to be on our 2017 list, as well as continuing what we call our setback planting program, which is where we reach out to those streets that don't have appropriate tree belts or no belts at all. They're either too narrow or they don't have tree belts at all. And we offer free trees. We will come and deliver them and plant them to any property that has a front yard that could accommodate a tree. And so this is a way of providing shade in the public right of way without the tree being on the public right of way itself. So finally, we're working on a 10-year plan based on the tree inventory, and it will execute over 10 years upwards of 3,000 new tree plantings. We are right now at the very early stages of working with the mayor to discuss options for financing this tree plan. And we are looking for every opportunity to leverage outside resources so that we can augment the city's financial investment with volunteer power, grants, business partnerships, every opportunity we can find to stretch our city dollars. And I'll just leave you with two things. One is that There is no other public infrastructure that appreciates in value as trees do. You put a gray infrastructure in the ground, it starts depreciating the moment it hits the ground. With a tree, it's the opposite. It starts appreciating in value. Its services increase over time. So that aggregate studies have shown that every dollar we invest in trees gives us a net $3 to $5 in return value over the lifetime of the tree. And I would say that with climate change upon us, shade trees are one of our city's best investments. So I thank you for supporting our program so far, and I look forward to the next 10 years and what we can accomplish together.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If begging everyone's indulgence, Kitty Colligan's here, and rather than if we could bring her up before the resolutions, that way she won't have to stay for another tiny eternity, and she has a brief announcement.
Yes. Well, I'm very pleased to be here to announce the living wage certified employers and aspiring employers from 2016. The living wage employers in 2016 had to pay at least $13.18 an hour to every single employee. And those employers are Acadia Herbals, Alexis Design, Allcraft Facial Plastic Surgery, Burroughs Weiss Mints and Lip Yellow, Center for New Americans, Chambers Advisory Group, Collective Copies, Community Legal Aid, Dobra Tea, Edwards Church, Etheridge and Stoyer, Fazzy Associates, First Churches of Northampton, Fly By Night, Gazebo, Haymarket Cafe, International Language Institute of Massachusetts, Indigo Coffee, The Jamrod Group, Law Office of Jesse Adams, Lesser Newman and Nasser, The Literacy Project, Market Street Research, Media Education Foundation, Minuteman Pest Control, National Priorities Project, Nanotech Resource Associates, Northampton Area Pediatrics, Northampton Community Music Center, Northampton Friends Meeting, Northampton Housing Authority, Northampton Survival Center, Ostrander Law Office, Pedal People, Pioneer Valley Worker Center, Richards Plumbing and Heating, Safe Passage, Sasson, Turnbull, Ryan, and Hoos, Unitarian Society of Northampton and Florence, United Way of Hampshire County, Valley Community Development Corporation, Valley Home Improvement Incorporation, Valley Medi Spa, Weber Grinnell Insurance Agency, Whalen Insurance, Wolf Family Dentistry, and Woodstar Cafe. The aspiring employers are employers who cannot now pay a living wage, but they aspire and make progress every year towards paying a living wage. And those employers are City of Northampton, Community Action, Raven Used Books, and the River Valley Co-op. And I ask you to support every one of these employers if you can, or as many as you can, and also to thank them for paying a living wage or making progress towards paying a living wage. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So the next item, we're into it now. We're at resolutions. This is item 17.287. This is a resolution in support of the Senate Bill 1305. That's an act to protect the civil rights and safety of all Massachusetts residents, AKA the Safe Communities Act, and this will be a first reading. So this is upon the recommendations of Councilor Lisa F. Klein, Councilor Maureen T. Carney, and Councilor Gina Louise Shara. Whereas Northampton Mayor David J. Narkowitz issued this city's executive order on August 28, 2014, directing the Northampton Police Department to, quote, not honor or enforce any detainer requests from U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, close quote, and despite threats from the current U.S. presidential administration, that federal grant funds to, quote, sanctuary cities, close quote, will be withdrawn, has pledged his continued commitment to ensuring that the order be enforced. And whereas the city of Whereas the Northampton City Council in its November 20th, 2014 resolution supporting the mayor's executive order committed to ensuring that the protections enforced in the order are applied consistently and fairly. And whereas in addition to Northampton, cities in Massachusetts, including Amherst, Somerville, Cambridge, Boston, Holyoke, Lawrence, Chelsea, Orleans, and Springfield have all passed trust acts, resolutions, or other policies designed to limit local law enforcement cooperation with Immigration and Customs Enforcement, also known as ICE, and are referred to as, quote, sanctuary cities, close quote. And whereas legal experts, including Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey, have stated that the proposal made by President Trump to strip sanctuary cities and cities of federal grant money is an unconstitutional attempt to coerce local policy by manipulating federal funds. And whereas the immigration enforcement in the United States was explicitly established as the responsibility of the federal government in Fong Yu Ting versus the U.S. in 1893, yet over the last two decades, local jurisdiction and states have been compelled to increase their immigration enforcement role, beginning primarily with the 287G provision of the Illegal Immigration and Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act of 1996, and increasing dramatically throughout the 21st century. And whereas increasing the cooperation between local law enforcement agencies and the Department of Homeland Security causes us to have significant constitutional and human rights concerns because of immigration enforcement practices such as racialized policing, lengthy periods of detention, excessive transfer of immigrant detainees, and violations of immigrants' rights to due process. And whereas studies have shown that immigrants are less likely to report crimes when state and local law enforcement agencies cooperate with federal immigration enforcement, and thus diminishing trust between communities and law enforcement and putting immigrant victims and potential victims at a heightened risk. And whereas the current bill in the 190th General Court of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Senate Bill 1305, an act to protect the civil rights and safety of all Massachusetts residents, also known as the Safe Communities Act, aims to protect all residents of Massachusetts and build trust within the communities by limiting cooperation between the local law enforcement agencies and ICE. And whereas the Safe Communities Act will ensure due process rights for people detained for civil immigration violations, prohibit law enforcement from inquiring about a person's immigration status unless required by law, prevent law enforcement agencies from arresting or detaining a person solely based on immigration status, and limit information sharing between state and local law enforcement and DHS. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts remains committed to ensuring equal, just, and fair treatment of all persons who live in and visit this city, and to maintaining our status as a sanctuary city. And be it further resolved that we support the Massachusetts Safe Communities Act and urge its passage by the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives. We ask that that Governor Charles Baker, who has expressed support for sanctuary cities, to support this statewide bill and to sign it in a timely manner to ensure the protection of all residents of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And be it further resolved that we commend and support State Representative Peter V. Cocott for being one of the petitioners of S-1305. And be it further resolved that the administrative assistant to the City Council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to U.S. Senator Elizabeth Warren, U.S. Senator Ed Markey, Massachusetts Governor Charles Baker, Massachusetts Attorney General Maura Healey, Massachusetts Senate President Stanley Rosenberg, Massachusetts State Representative Peter V. Cocott, the original co-sponsors of S-1305, Massachusetts Senator James B. Eldridge, and Massachusetts Representative Juana Matias, and the co-chairs of the Mass Legislature's Joint Committee on Public Safety and Homeland Security, and Massachusetts Senator James E. Timilty, and Massachusetts Representative Harold E. Knopf. I'll accept a motion to put this on the floor.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion.
Well, before I offer some remarks about the resolution, I'd like to offer amended language for the first whereas. And I have not talked to the co-sponsors about this, so it's new to them as well. Where it says, whereas Northampton Mayor David Narkowitz issued the city's executive order, blah, 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 to not honor or enforce any detainer request from U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, before the close quote, quoting that executive order, I'd like to add the rest of that sentence from the executive order to clarify that is non-criminal and not subject to a judicially issued warrant. Does that make sense to everyone? I just didn't quote enough in the writing there. And so there was some confusion.
From the order.
Right. And I offer this amendment because I was asked by two different people for clarification regarding the city's sanctuary policy. People said, do these detainers even mention warrants for criminal activity or just immigration status? And so it made me realize that the first whereas had incomplete language that was taken from the Mayor Narkowitz's executive order. So I wanted that to be rectified and clarify that we're talking about non-criminal warrants.
That's a proposed amendment. Are
yes.
there other amendments that you have?
No.
Okay.
A second.
So this is on the amendments. Any discussion on the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment as proposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
So I'd like to just kind of explain that a little bit more. That a detainer request, I'm sorry, I'm suffering from a cold. A detainer request from ICE is not criminal in nature. It has to be accompanied by a criminal warrant, which isn't totally clear, I think. A detainer request would be issued when ICE suspects undocumented status of somebody, but there have been many incidences when they've been wrong. And two federal courts, Miami-Dade Court and an Illinois federal court, have both ruled that detainer requests are unconstitutional. The federal government is constitutionally prohibited from forcing local authorities to detain someone based on immigration status, and local authorities are prohibited from complying with that demand. In fact, in passing the Safe Communities Act, essentially what we're doing here is simply ensuring that the state is respecting the U.S. Constitution and the Massachusetts Declaration of Rights. When state and local law enforcement officials are asked to carry out orders issued under Trump's immigration policies and before his Obama's as well, they are being asked to act without respect for the due process and equal protection rights enshrined in these documents. Specifically, and according to the Massachusetts ACLU, state and local officers who arrest people based solely on ICE detainers undertake unreasonable search and seizure. Massachusetts officers cannot make warrantless arrests for civil immigration offenses. Because ICE detainers do not supply probable cause to believe that someone is removable and likely to escape, state and local officers who arrest people based solely on those ICE detainers also are undertaking unreasonable seizures prohibited by the Fourth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution and in Massachusetts, Article 14 of the Massachusetts Declaration of Rights. So that is just a little bit of explanation behind this resolution to support the Safe Communities Act at the state level.
Other discussion points, Councilor Sherrod?
I'm not going to sort of belabor the point about what we think about Northampton or other cities as sanctuary cities, because I think that this body has very clearly stated our support indeed in action of that. But I think that there is value in and power in declaring and pushing our support as a commonwealth, which is what this Safe Communities Act is about. And the governor has very clearly acknowledged and stated his support that that cities and towns have rights in this regard, and that the federal government has no right to control our local police or command them to enforce federal immigration law. And he also seems to recognize that that doesn't impede local law enforcement from doing their jobs. So it's not clear why he says he supports cities asserting their rights and yet says that his own administration will continue to, quote, will continue to enforce policies giving the state police the tools necessary to detain violent criminals or suspected terrorists wanted by federal authorities, end quote. So if cities can conduct law enforcement while also not engaging in practices designed to ferret out immigration status for non-criminal activity, and also not comply with retainer requests that are non-criminal or without a judicial warrant. And that works for cities, according to the governor. I'm not sure how you would hold the view that it doesn't work for the Commonwealth or for state police. So I would like the governor to reconsider his stance, which seems paradoxical to me. And I hope that this act will cross his desk and that he will reconsider it and sign it. So.
Other discussion? Councilor Donald?
Oh, I would defer to Councilor Carney if she. Okay. I just would like to offer an amendment that I think expands on it. There's first a couple of small things. I'm not sure which paragraph number we're looking at, but the one that says, whereas in addition to Northampton, cities in Massachusetts, et cetera, should say cities and towns. Another small one I'll deal with in a second. The substantive one I wanted to suggest has to do with the functioning of the Safe Communities Act. And I'd like to suggest amending it to kind of flesh out a little bit more of what it does. Starting with the clause, you know, this paragraph describes the things that this does. Starting with the clause, prevent law enforcement agencies from arresting or detaining a person solely based on immigration status. And then it goes on and says, and limit. I'd like it to say, prohibit information sharing from state and law, from state and local law enforcement and the Registry of Motor Vehicles to DHS for the purposes of enforcement of any federal program requiring registrations of persons on the basis of race, gender, sexual orientation, religion, or national or ethnic origin, and prohibit local law enforcement, including county sheriffs, from ordering their employees to act as immigration agents. And I'll explain that if the amendment gets on the floor. And finally, I'd just like to suggest, I mean, the advocates can tell me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure the Speaker of the House also has voiced his opposition to the statewide law. So unless, that was the last I heard from Speaker DeLeo, so unless I'm wrong, I think we should call him out too. Because frankly, nothing's gonna get to the governor's desk unless the Speaker of the House changes his position. But perhaps he has. Maybe I'm behind the eight ball on that. I'll explain those further if it's someone wants to second it.
Well, you proposed one essentially Scrivener's change and then one a substantive change on the last whereas. And you have one more?
I can actually read out what, I mean, if you wanted to add Speaker DeLeo, you would change. You would separate the paragraph that contains the clause. We ask that Governor Baker, who has, and we would change it to, be it further resolved, the City Council asks Governor Charles Baker and Speaker Robert DeLeo, who have both opposed a statewide law, to reconsider their positions. So that would be the textual, if that would encapsulate what I'm trying to
do. So that amendment comes in the second resolve.
Mm-hmm.
Councilor O'Donnell's proposed amendments. Does someone want to second them, or second them separately, or?
Happy to take them separately if that's easier. Yeah.
Is there a second for?
Second.
There is a second. Okay. And for in total, for all three proposed amendments.
I'm fine with doing all three, but if you'd rather separate them.
Okay. So discussion on the
Thank
amendments.
Thank you. Can I just explain? I mean,
please. Yeah.
You know, when we say limit information sharing, it's not just to limit it generally. It's for the purposes of preventing the establishment of, I think, what people expect would be a Muslim registry, quite frankly. I mean, that's what President Trump campaigned on and has suggested. And this says that we wouldn't share information for the purposes of registration of people with totally unconstitutional and un-American proposal to register people on any of those bases that I describe. And also, it would explicitly prevent local law enforcement from deputizing their employees to act as immigration agents. I mean, the sheriff of Bristol County in Massachusetts is continually seeks headlines and recently said he would come out and arrest us, you know, based on some unknown interpretation of the law which is puzzling to me how someone who is involved in law enforcement could, I think, knowingly misinterpret the law for his own, I don't know, public relations gain, I guess. But it would say that we're not going to allow taxpayer resources to in any way enable that. I think that's an important part of the Safe Communities Act that I would just like to specifically mention.
Councilor Bidwell.
Just as a clarification. Mm-hmm. So the language that you're proposing more fully explains the existing language in the proposed Safe Communities Act?
Yes.
Okay, so it's not a...
It's not my idea.
It's not a recommended improvement on that act. It just more fully explains it.
Exactly.
Okay.
Other questions or...
Yeah, I guess I like the content of that language. I'm just not sure. I have to go back and read the Safe Communities Act.
Okay.
To be able to kind of fully see how it integrates. And it's also very hard. I just would want to see the language before we get it in there. I actually have to visually see it. That's my only issue.
The language of the state bill or the amendment that I...
The amendment, the language of the amendment. Is it language that's taken directly from the Safe Communities Act? Is it a word for word?
Not word for word, no. And we do have it in text form, and I mean, our administrative assistant could put it on the screen, but happy to wait for second reading if that's what the sponsors want to do. I just think the merits of it are important and deserve to be called out.
Yeah. And I appreciate the addition of Speaker DeLeo, so I think that's a great amendment.
Maybe he'll change his mind by second reading based on the Northampton City Council's.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Actually, I would check on that because.
Sharon, I'm sorry, you can't speak during this point. Okay. But we will be following up on that. We're going to follow up and see what the sense that I'm getting here with the proposed amendment, but at least the particular, the most substantive one, is to hold that in abeyance till the second reading. Does that seem
certainly
reasonable?
Acceptable to me? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Give you an opportunity, the sponsors an opportunity to read and maybe enhance and massage it a little more, maybe in consultation with Councilor O'Donnell. So without objection, I think I'll remove that from the amendment proposal currently on the floor and then keep and retain the 2 points, adding Speaker DeLeo in the calling out section of politicians, and then also including towns, because actually, and I think that's more a Scrivener's error, because you do the many Chelsea, Orleans, they are, and Amherst are towns for the time being, as it is, and so is Cambridge, so City of Cambridge, I'm sorry. So that change would have it in the third whereas, including the word towns, cities and towns in Massachusetts, and then in the final, in the, what did we say it was? The second to last resolve? No, where is it? The last resolve.
Third
is you mailing everybody on
third
the planet.
Last.
So the second resolve. Including, we ask that ask that Governor Charles Baker and Speaker DeLeo, who has expressed support for sanctuary cities, has he expressed support for sanctuary cities? He hasn't done that either.
I would suggest that it says, and actually it's up on the screen, we just break that paragraph into two and create another resolve. So it reads, be it further resolved that the City Council asked Governor Charles Baker and Speaker Robert DeLeo, both opposed statewide law, to reconsider their positions. Although, if the advocates want to check on that, I'm happy to wait for that as well. So, but yeah, that's how I would do it, like that.
Okay, let's see.
Is that the sense of the sponsors? Is there any desire to wait on changing that paragraph? I'm just reporting my last understanding.
Yeah, I think as a fact check, it might be prudent for us to do that, to just double check that we're...
Well, so I'll withdraw that section, if I may.
So why don't we hold then that the only amendment currently proposed is to include the word towns.
Well, can I, since I want to make the most confusing amendment in the history of the City Council,
oh,
just add a small... I says, no, you can handle it. I just want to add a small technical, you know, we're saying we support. I think it should say, be it further resolved, that the City Council supports the Massachusetts Safe Communities Act and urges its passage, instead of we. I think that's correct.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
I'm a little confused about that one because in many of our resolutions, our first resolve is the City Council of Northampton, and I think the further resolves are often we, because it's clear that we're the same body with all of our resolves.
Okay, fine.
So I don't know if that's necessary. I mean, that would not be in keeping with many past resolutions that we've written and passed. So
certainly, I'll defer the sponsors on that. I would like to add towns. Thank you.
All right. So the amendment is to include the word town.
And towns.
And towns.
And towns, I'm sorry.
It's a two-word amendment.
It would say, in addition to Northampton, cities and towns in Massachusetts, including, and then the list of the cities and towns. Any further discussion on and towns? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Now we're back to the body of the resolution. Further discussion. Councilor Carney.
Oh, thank you.
As a sponsor.
All right. I just wanted to express my appreciation to Councilor Klein for doing the bulk of this drafting, and also to Councilor Shearer for co-sponsoring and for being asked to sponsor it. I think it's so important that we're able to lead by example and to show by this resolution that we can see what we're trying to do here in Northampton across Massachusetts. So we heard Peter Coquett speak very passionately about this as being one item coming up, and if there's a way that we can be influential with this resolution, I'm just happy that we can do that.
Councilor Bidwell.
I'd like to speak in enthusiastic support of the resolution as well. On the merits of it, which have been well described, but also not only would we be joining forces with other cities and towns in the Commonwealth, but we would be joining with city councils and mayors and aldermen across the country. There's a growing movement and a growing network of so-called sanctuary cities who in some cases are now pressing their own legislatures at the state level to become sanctuary states. That's underway in California, and it's in discussion elsewhere. So we're not only showing solidarity with other communities within the Commonwealth, but we're joining with communities around the country, building a groundswell, which makes it particularly important that we jump on board here and show leadership.
I think it's important to address the president and his minions' threat to withhold federal funding for communities that are identified as sanctuary cities. And we have to point out, of course, sanctuary cities is not a legal term of any sort. And it actually promises more than it can deliver and threatens more than is available. But the most important part is this has actually already been decided in law. The mm-hmm. president cannot withhold federal funds to compel a community to essentially do something that may be construed as unconstitutional. Ironically, it was decided in the most recent Supreme Court, Justice Roberts, in fact, writing the majority opinion relative to the Affordable Care Act and Barack Obama's intent to try and compel communities to abide by the conditions of the ACA by threatening to withhold federal funds. He said it can't be done. That's not right. Also, ironically, it was also relative to President Obama lost another case under the Supreme Court trying to compel communities to develop a reasonable gun regulation. So far, President Trump's team actually has already set him up for failure for this really hollow and empty threat, and it's saber-rattling. And I understand that does cause concerns for a lot of people in the community, separate from whatever concerns they have relative to their notions of immigration. But
the fact is we are not in peril or jeopardy of losing federal funds, regardless, you know. I mean, we're more likely to be attacked by the Vincent fleet than actually the president circumventing federal, already decided federal law. So we don't, and that's not to say that if we were suddenly under threat that we would lose potential funds. I think the mayor has been quite courageous in stating unequivocally that we will deal with that when and if that comes, and it doesn't seem likely. And the fact is we're still committed to these processes and can't be threatened with, well, kind of grotesque unconstitutional threats. The fact remains, we are actually protected by the Constitution. We're protected by the Supreme Court. Many of us wouldn't even agree with on a good day. But that actually, we are already okay in that respect. So I want people to understand going forward that these are virtuous aspirations, and the consequences that have been threatened are not likely to be realized. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Scherer?
Yes.
That passes unanimously in first reading. We have another resolution you may have heard about. This is item 17.295. This is a resolution calling on the Massachusetts legislature to establish a carbon pollution pricing curb to curb climate change. And this is also upon the recommendation of Councillor Elisa F. Klein, Councillor Maureen T. Carney, and Councillor Dennis P. Bidwell, and also the Energy and Sustainability Commission here in the City of Northampton. Whereas the scientific consensus firmly holds that catastrophic climate change is taking place, and burning of fossil fuels with its resultant carbon emission pollution is among the chief contributing factors. And whereas the climate crisis is a serious threat to the current and future generations here in the City of Northampton and all over the world. And whereas the City of Northampton has a responsibility to protect the lives and the livelihoods of our residents from the threat of climate change. And whereas the use of fossil fuels is pervasive in the City of Northampton, the state of Massachusetts, and throughout the country and the world. And whereas the United States free market offers a fertile environment for creation of a diverse set of economical services and products in the areas of conservation, efficiency, and renewable energy to allow us to wean ourselves off fossil fuels. And whereas free markets operate most efficiently when individuals and corporations are held accountable for the cost of their actions. And whereas the empirical evidence shows that the price changes shift behavior, so by establishing carbon pollution pricing, we can spur innovation of less environmentally onerous ways of providing and consuming goods and services. And whereas prices for fossil fuels do not reflect the cost of health impacts, climate change, and other environmental degradations that are associated with the pervasive fossil fuel use and carbon emissions. And whereas climate experts, congressional leaders, and organizations from around the country have advanced proposals and legislative bills to rectify this cost, this price-cost disparity by imposing fees on carbon pollution emissions, including well-known Earth Environmental Science professor and climate change expert James Hansen, U.S. Senators Barbara Boxer, Bernie Sanders, and Sheldon Whitehouse, Public Citizen and Citizens Climate Lobby. And whereas in October 2016, the Massachusetts Legislature's Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy held a hearing on carbon pollution pricing proposals, including Senate Bill 1747, an act combating climate change, and Senate Bill 1786, an act to protect our environment and reduce the carbon footprint of the Commonwealth, at which the testimony was strongly in favor of enacting carbon pollution pricing. And whereas British Columbia implemented carbon pollution pricing in 2008, according to a 2014 report in The Economist. British Columbia's economy is as strong as and arguably better than the rest of Canada, while the carbon pricing is successfully driving environmental gains. And whereas on June 9th, 2014, Citizens Climate Lobby released a study from the Regional Economic Models Incorporated,
that examined the impact of a steadily rising fee on carbon-based fuels with revenue from the fee returned to households in equal shares, with the fee starting at $10 per ton of carbon dioxide and rising $10 per ton each year. And the major findings were, in 20 years, CO2 emissions would be reduced 50% below the 1990 levels. And because of the economic stimulus of recycling carbon fee revenue back to the households, in 20 years, 2.8 million jobs would be added to the American economy. And improved air quality would result in 230,000, it would result in 230,000 premature deaths avoided over 20 years. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts strongly urges the Massachusetts legislature to pass legislation that puts a gradually increasing fee on carbon and fossil fuels to make individuals and corporations accountable for the cost of their actions when they choose to use fossil fuels, level the economic playing field between fossil fuels and conservation efficiency renewable energy sources, and ignite a free market-based clean energy revolution. And be it further resolved that we strongly urge the Massachusetts legislature to include a provision in the carbon pollution pricing legislation that it passes to ensure that most economically vulnerable residents of Massachusetts are not caused any undue financial hardship because of the law. And be it further resolved that the administrative assistant of the City Council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to the Massachusetts Governor Charles Baker, State Treasurer Deborah B. Goldberg, Massachusetts Senate President Stanley C. Rosenberg, Massachusetts Speaker of the House Robert A. DeLeo, Massachusetts Representative Peter Kokot, Senate Chair of the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, Energy, Senator Michael J. Barrett, House Chair of the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy, State Representative Thomas A. Golden, Jr., Senate Vice President of the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy, and God, I wish that committee had a smaller name, Michael D. Brady, House Vice Chair of the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy, Taki Chan, and all members of the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy, Senators Mark R. Pacheco, N. M. Gobi, Joan B. Lovely, Bruce E. Tarr, and Representatives James M. Cantwell, Carolyn Dykema, Nick Collins, Josh S. Cutler, Adrian Madaro, Daniel Cahill, Joe Machino, Leonard Mira, and Randy Hunt, and U.S. Senator Elizabeth Warren, and U.S. Senator Ed Markey.
Trying to keep Pam busy.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of envelopes. I'll accept a motion. Put this on. It's a motion. The motion's made and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Klein.
All right. So I have some remarks about this one too. We're at a critical juncture in the health of our planet, and that behooves us to do everything we can to reverse impending climate chaos. And lest I sound histrionic using that term, climate chaos, I'd like to remind everyone that here in the United States we have a man like Scott Pruitt heading up the Environmental Protection Agency, who, as Marty Nathan reminded me, the New York Times wrote, has worked for many years arm in arm with major oil and gas producers, electric industry giants, and groups linked to the Koch brothers to end environmental regulations that, although have been insufficient in the current landscape of climate change, they were our last kind of bulwark against even more rapid destruction of the planet. So it means that we have to act locally and at the state level to push back and prevent further climate change. And carbon pollution pricing is one powerful way that we can do this. It's generally agreed across the political spectrum that by putting a price on carbon pollution, we can effectively cut greenhouse gas emissions. Carbon pollution pricing would give people who produce energy and consumers an incentive to move away from the current heavy usage of fossil fuels that we see across this country, and an incentive to produce and use clean energy instead. If we do this in Massachusetts, we can use the revenue from the carbon pollution pricing fees in two significant ways. One, we can provide rebates to residents, thus raising income and spending levels statewide. And part of the revenue can also be used to build our clean energy infrastructure, clean tech services, thus creating an economic and employment boost for the state. And this was mentioned by some folks who spoke, our public transportation infrastructure. So a carbon pricing fee would have the very desirable dual effect of both invigorating the economy while also helping the state achieve a significant reduction in greenhouse gas emissions and thus climate change. As the resolution says, in the last session of the Massachusetts legislature, there were two carbon pricing bills that were introduced. A hearing was held in the Joint Committee on Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy with overwhelming support expressed, yet the bills died in committee. This session, there are again two bills. Adele Franks, in her public comment, mentioned both of them. The bills are a little bit more robust this time around carbon pricing, one in the Senate and one in the House. There's Senator Michael Barrett's S-1821, an act combating climate change. It has 64 petitioners. And Representative Jennifer Benson's H-1726, an act to promote green infrastructure, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and create jobs. And that's in the House with 59 petitioners. And I mentioned the number of co-petitioners, co-sponsors on these bills because they represent over a third of our state legislators, which is significant because it's a larger number by about 30 legislators than signed on as petitioners in the last session in the in the state House, which I think is just significant because it shows that just in a matter of months, the interest and support for these bills has grown quite a bit. So my feeling about this is that we need to add our local voices to this call to ensure that carbon pollution pricing becomes a reality here in Massachusetts and that it does not die in committee this year as it did last year. With this resolution, we can make clear that throughout Massachusetts, we want to do all we can to slow climate change down and that we have strong methods to do that if we actually utilize them. I have some people I want to thank for the work that they did with me on this bill. Sharon Moulton, who is still here. Adele Franks. Is Adele still here?
Yep.
Hi, Adele. These are Northampton residents who've been very helpful to me in bringing this resolution to the floor tonight. I want to thank the Northampton Energy and Sustainability Commission and particularly the Sustainability Officer for Northampton, Chris Mason, Councillor Dwight, who sits with me on the commission, and the resolution's co-sponsors, Councillor Carney and Councillor Bidwell. There are others in Northampton who've been working long and hard on combating climate change, and I really want to give a shout out to them, people like Marty Nathan, who was here, Reverend Andrea Vazian, and so many others in their organizations. Climate Action Now has been really key here in Northampton in getting this onto the floor tonight. Mothers Out Front, Citizens Climate Lobby, and 2 Degrees. So I have another amended language suggestion. Before I end, I was thinking that we need to express some explicit support for the two most current carbon pricing bills. We did purposefully leave this. We were not suggesting, like we did with the Safe Communities Act, a very particular one of these bills because we wanted to leave it broader and we wanted them actually to be expanded beyond the language of the bills that are in the State House now. But I think we do need to include something about the bills that are currently being considered in the State House. So those would be S-1821 and H-1726. I can send exact language to you, Pam, but I think the language could be added as follows. After the whereas that mentions the two bills from last session, we would add another whereas that says, whereas in the current session of the Massachusetts legislature, two carbon pricing related bills have been introduced, name the bills, and are being co-sponsored by over a third of our state legislators. So that is an amendment that I'm putting on the floor.
Second.
Second amendment. So the two sponsors just definitely qualify for a friendly amendment. Discussion on the amendment? Councilor Bidwell, the other sponsor?
I definitely support the inclusion of those two specific bills. And would you consider as an additional friendly amendment, this is pretty picky, but where there's a reference to the state of Massachusetts, we should perhaps call it the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
Mm. Yes. That's not picky at all. That's something very basic that I'm careful about.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, this is to the amendment. Any discussion on the amendments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So is it back to the body of the resolution? Councilor Carney?
Okay. I wanted to, again, thank Councilor Klein for her leadership on this. This is such an important issue. We've heard from folks in public comment. There's one thing that really drew my attention, and I think when Adele Franks mentioned it too, I had looked in, that was that green infrastructure fund that is referenced in Representative Benson's bill that's in the House now. And that seemed as though it was something that at least really set aside money, resources to make those investments in renewable energy that we really need to do. And on a local level, I mean, we know that it's only been, I think it's been 2 years now since the closing of the Mount Tom plant. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's just been in the last couple of months, the last plant in Brayton Point down in Plymouth also closed. And there, we really need to be able to provide opportunities for those folks who've been dislocated as we transition away from carbon and fossil-based fuels. So I think that any bill and anything that we look to really needs to invest in workers and training, and not only for their benefit, but to be able to meet the demand once, as this resolution references, once the clean energy revolution is ignited. So I'm really happy to be a co-sponsor of this resolution and urge my colleagues to pass.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes, I'm going to support this resolution. I highly believe in this bill. And I also want to state how we heard Lil Bombard mention about the planting of trees. And I think it is the best thing that you ever could do for climate change, and also for the interest in the environment for all our families from generation to generation.
Thank you. Councilor Bidwell.
I just want to say how pleased I am to be a co-sponsor of this resolution, and I want to acknowledge the leadership and the hard work of Councilor Klein in putting it together and working with so many folks in the community that have been working so hard on this. I've for some time been attracted to just the basic logic and simplicity and demonstrated effectiveness of a carbon pricing policy. For three very basic reasons. One, it does acknowledge that there are enormous costs to extracting fossil fuels and transporting them and burning them that have not been reflected in the way they are priced. And this is a way to rectify them, to acknowledge that the pricing should correspond to the true cost of use of these fuels. And second, this has been amply described. Economists all across the spectrum who don't agree on much would agree that when you substantially increase the price to consumers of something, you're going to decrease their consumption. In fact, many believe that this is perhaps the best single policy fix that could move us dramatically in the direction of complying with our Commonwealth's own goal of by 2050, getting to greenhouse gas emissions at a level 80% below the 1990 level. This is probably the best policy fix there is to get us there. And the third, again, very common sense thing about this is that the revenues collected in both of these bills before the legislature would largely go back to the citizens of the Commonwealth. One of them would have some of those dollars set aside for green infrastructure. I would be supportive of either approach. I certainly understand the political logic of a solution that says this is revenue neutral. This isn't a grab on the Commonwealth's part to get more dollars. We want to emerge revenue neutral, but to have in the process essentially shifted dollars from users of fossil fuels to other folks in the general Commonwealth. So I'm supportive of either of those approaches. I think we shouldn't sacrifice a relatively small part of it for the larger goal of getting carbon pricing. So I'm very pleased to be a sponsor of this important resolution.
Councilor Scherr.
I wholeheartedly support this, and I very much thank the sponsors for it. And I also want to just note that I appreciate the section that's asking for a provision to protect economically vulnerable residents. Particularly in the beginning, we would want to safeguard against any aspects that could disproportionately affect lower income residents who rely on fossil fuels and don't have the means to easily adapt that dependence. And as many noted tonight eloquently, lower income communities have always suffered the most from pollution and environmental destruction. And it's on their backs that so much profit has been made. So I just wanted to note that aspect is in there. So thank you.
Well, it was a question of a comment, and I think it's important to reiterate the fact that and we often get asked, you know, what's with these resolutions? They actually don't do anything. These don't carry the weight of law. This carries, they're aspirational documents. And this point has been made brilliantly clear and evident, I think, with the most recent election, that the national, we've developed a dependency on the federal government to help mitigate some of these identified crises that we're addressing tonight. And now that we can't do that anymore. And in fact, actually, we may be even cross purposes. But the fact is that this, what it does is reassert the relevance and importance of local and regional governments and state government. It is California that set the standards for the EPA. The state of Washington that actually does, I believe, have a carbon offset.
Didn't pass.
California does, though. But the fact is that it's clearly California carries a little more weight than we do, given I think it's like the seventh largest economy in the world. We're not quite that big. But the fact is that this is the state where equal marriage was started. There's now the law of the land. This is the state that actually is over and over again reiterated its commitment to reducing our contribution, our tiny contribution comparatively, to the resulting climate change. So this has value. It has value despite the fact there are people who might claim otherwise. Congressman McGovern has said over and over again that it's really important for him to go, when he goes before Congress, that he doesn't act as an individual, he acts as a representative of communities that have spoken quite clearly and definitively on particular issues, and he can present them with evidence of the documents of these resolutions. He needs that in his quiver. The representatives, our local legislative body in Senator Stan Rosenberg and Representative Peter Kokot, also need that support and know that they can say the communities in my district speak very loudly and clearly and unequivocally on these issues. It helps them make their case. So with that said, let's see if we can do that. Is there any other discussion on this point? Councilor O'Donnell.
I just would also like to voice my support and thank members of the council who worked on this and showed leadership on it. And I also like to maybe echo what others have said, but in a different way with regards to the fact that this really came to us from the community. And I think it shows that when it comes to public interest legislation, there's a filter. And as the council president said, maybe there's the thickest, most difficult filter at the federal level right now. I think the federal policy coming from the federal government, especially about the environment, is not really reflecting what the people of this country want. It's not reflecting what they need. And Councilor Sherry made a great point about who it affects most when action is not taken. You have maybe a less difficult filter at the state level. We see that a third of the general court is sponsoring this. But maybe it's at the local level where the filter is the thinnest. And what I am most proud of is that this council, I think, is reacting swiftly and probably unanimously, I'm thinking, to activism from the people who are bringing this forward. And we're reacting to activism from people who care about this and who care about our world and our country. And hopefully this vote tonight will reflect that and show an additional level of meaning. So that's what's important to me about this, so thank you.
It's worth noting that a third of this body also are petitioners for this as well. All right.
Okay.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading unanimously. And I have a question of the petitioners. Originally, there was some urgency or some sense of urgency when this was first introduced. Does that urgency still hold a desire for a second reading, or are you comfortable waiting till the next council meeting?
There's no hearing scheduled for this right now, so I think that we can give it the 2 weeks, and it also gives, I think, the community a little bit of time and space to hear more about it, and so I'm fine waiting for 2 weeks.
Okay. All right. So that will be the second meeting will be at our next meeting for this.
5 minute break.
Okay with that?
Yeah. There's been a request for a recess, so we'll take 8.5 minutes, 2/3 minutes.
We'll put the timer on.
Okay, well, we're coming out of recess here. Slowly but surely, we're coming out of recess and we're reconvening right now, actually, as I speak. And we come up to the next item on the agenda, which is the consent agenda. The consent agenda includes an approval of the minutes of April 6th of the 2017 meeting. Item 17.290, and that's petitions for junk dealer licenses. It's a renewal license for Richard and Sharon Huntley, 254 East Hampton Road. Richard Huntley is the petitioner. Norman Menard of 25 Garfield Avenue. Norman Menard is also the petitioner. Also petition for truck licenses. This is a renewal license for Bill Willard Incorporated. That's three trucks, and Joanne Morin is the petitioner. Petition for pool table licenses. That's the renewal of license for Packards at 14 Masonic Street, a Sunday license, and then the renewal license for Packards on 14 Masonic Street for a weekday license. Robert McGovern is petitioner. Then we have petitions, excuse me, for bowling licenses. Northampton Bowl at 525 Pleasant Street, that's a Sunday license, and Northampton Bowl 525 Pleasant Street also for a weekday license. J. Michael Corley is the petitioner. And then item 17.294, petitions for annual secondhand dealer licenses, a new license for Castle Architectural Salvage at 7 Pearl Street. Ronald J. Pike is the petitioner. Renewal licenses for the following: Urban Exchange at 233 Main Street. Sylvia Nomberg is the petitioner. Stuart F. Solomon Antiques at 28 North Maple Street in Florence. Stuart F. Solomon is the petitioner. Roz's Place, 6 Bridge Street. Timothy Saldo is the petitioner. Jack Spire Antiques at 416 North Main Street in Leeds. Jack Spire is the petitioner. Cancer Connection at 375 South Street. Nancy Charbonneau Case is the petitioner. The family jewels at 25 Green Street. Richard J. Stone is the petitioner. Also Norman E. Menard again at 25 Garfield Avenue. He is the petitioner as well. Electric Eye Record at 52 Main Street, Suite Number 6 in Florence. Andrew Crespo is the petitioner. And last, and this is for referral 17296, is appointments to the Council on Aging. Mary Listowski of 84 Bridge Street, Northampton, the term to begin April 2017, expiring June 2020. This is a reappointment. And then Lorraine Wyman, 300 Acre Book Drive in Florence, a term starting April 2017, expiring June 2020, also reappointment.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, and any discussion? No discussion on the items.
We can't.
No, I'm sorry. Unless you want to remove something from the agenda.
Is there any way that we can address the question of the use of the new the forms that we have created for the wage theft question?
Right. Okay. That's. Yeah, Councilor O'Donnell.
Suggest we remove one such item.
So that, for purposes of the discussion. Sure. So not to single it out, but let's say the new license for Castle Salvage. How's that? Since they're new folks. And so there's been a request to remove one item. So to the bulk of the consent agenda, it's been motioned and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, now this is for the new license for Castle Architectural Salvage on 7 Pearl Street. Ronald J. Pike is the petitioner. And Councilor Klein.
Well, I just wanted to, because it's a new procedure that we pass the wage theft order for the licenses that the council has to approve. So there was some question about how we would in fact enforce it. Now that we have the opportunity, I'm going to put Councilor Carney on the spot with the form itself to explain.
I hope that you saw the form that was attached. So the form was essentially just a restatement of the council order itself. It just states the council order and has a set of check boxes where the applicant can certify their compliance with wage and hour law.
And that they are not currently under investigation nor have suffered any conviction.
There it is.
So this is the first round of licensees that have had to fill this out, essentially, and I just thought that was important for people watching to know.
Yeah, we did hear soon after from the city clerk needing to get that form in order for the applicants that were coming out, so that was simply, I think, an administrative thing. I worked with administrative assistant, and Pam worked with clerk's office, and we got them the forms in anticipation of their applications. So this is one such form.
Yep.
Yeah.
There it is.
Councilor O'Donnell and Councilor Bidwell.
I really think this deserves recognition for Councilor Carney and Councilor Klein and others, because this is, I don't know, a big improvement, and now we're changing the way we do things. And so congratulations and thank you.
Councilor Bidwell.
Just as a clerical matter, I noticed one of the forms. I don't know if it was for state taxes or city taxes. There's some reference to referral to the City Council Committee on Licenses, which, of course, is a committee that doesn't exist. So at some point, not a big deal, but.
You're talking about this one?
Yeah.
The tax.
So that would be the Committee on Community Resources.
Oh, is this the taxi stuff? Yeah.
Okay, so that. That'll be updated then. Okay. Good catch.
The city clerk has that particular form in her office, so I'll get her a new one.
Okay. Any other discussion on this application?
No.
Thank you for the update on that. Councilor O'Donnell?
We need a motion on it, so I'd move to approve it.
Thank you.
Second.
Any no further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. So now we recess for the Committee on Finance, and that is chaired by Councilor David Murphy. Here will be presiding.
Thank you. So I'll call the meeting in order and ask Pam to call the roll of Finance.
Councilor Murphy?
I'm here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor Large?
Present.
Councilor Nash?
Excellent. The first order of business is to approve minutes from March 28th and from April 6th. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve.
Second. Any corrections, changes? Hearing none, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. All right, we have two financial orders tonight, only two. First is 17297. It's an order to approve appropriation for conversion from prior year funding of EMS stipends to current funding of EMS stipends. Order that $415,000 be appropriated from the FY17 general fund undesignated fund balance to the fire department's stipend line item for purposes of implementing a one-time conversion from prior year funding of EMS stipends to current funding of EMS stipends. We have a motion, finance.
Make a motion.
Second. And the mayor's here to answer any questions.
So as the councilors may recall, when we met in executive session back at the beginning of the year, I can't even remember when it was, to discuss this particular contract, which is now a completed contract. One of the changes that we negotiated with Local 108, as well as the deputy fire chiefs, was the way that EMT stipends, we made a sort of radical change to the EMT stipends, moved away from the prior revenue and profit sharing model and per call based stipends, and went to just a straight set fixed stipend for whatever your level, whether you're basic, advanced, or paramedic, you'd have a fixed stipend. So the way the old system worked is because it was based on percentage of the revenue, we would wait till the end of the fiscal year to understand how much revenue was put in, and then in the next fiscal year, we would pay the stipends for the prior fiscal year. So basically, that's not going to be necessary anymore because it's not going to be based on the prior year profit. It's going to be a flat stipend. So we're basically switching to sort of forward funding now. So we're going to fund in the same year. But in this conversion year, it means that when we wrote the FY17 budget, we included money for the FY16 stipends, and we paid them for last year. And so now the new contract requires that we pay the new stipends in the current fiscal year. So that's why we need to have additional funds in this current fiscal year to pay the stipends at the end of FY17 in June. Again, this will be a one-time occurrence because going forward, we'll just be budgeting the stipends for 18, for 19. So there's no extra stipends being paid. It's just that we were paying them sort of looking backwards every year, and now we're just going to start paying them in the current year.
Questions for the mayor? Hearing none. All in favor of a positive recommendation of finance?
Aye.
Aye.
Say aye. Aye.
Aye. No opposed. All right. Thank you.
And then the next one is accepting a donation to the city at 17298 in order to accept the donation of an Eaton rack uninterrupted power source with a value of $20,000. Order that the Northampton City Council gratefully accepts the donation of 4 Eaton rack uninterrupted power source units valued at $20,000, a gift to the city of Northampton for the Northampton Public Schools from Smith College in accordance with Mass General Law Chapter 44, Section 53A. Do we have a motion and finance?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second.
Questions for the mayor on this one?
So the city council did adopt an order that allowed the schools to accept gifts up to $10,000. So we sort of had that order in place, and $10,000 was the threshold. So because we are concerned that this gift exceeds that, and these are basically units that I believe are being taken out of the Clark Science Center at Smith, and they were going to be sort of surplused, and they're actually newer and in better condition than our uninterrupted power source units, which are basically a kind of a battery backup, so that if you have a power failure, it keeps your network equipment running. And so we're going to retrofit both at Northampton High School and JFK, our UPS systems there with these units. So the school committee voted last week to accept the gift. Mr. Pagan has been in close contact with the IT folks at Smith, so he knows what we're getting and he has approved it. So the school committee has accepted it, and we now need the city council to accept because it's a gift of real property.
Questions? Hearing none, all in favor of the positive recommendation. And finance,
aye.
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 Any opposed? And I know of no new business. So a motion to adjourn finance.
Move to adjourn. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And go into the regular body of the meeting. And starting off with the financial order 17.297. That's an order to approve appropriation for conversion from the prior year funding of EMS stipends to the current funding of EMS stipends.
Move to approve.
Motion's made in second. Any further discussion on this item? Other questions? Roll call.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Okay, passes in first reading. Item 17.267, this is an order to authorize payment for our prior year bill for veteran services, second reading. I'm sorry, you know what, let's get back to the Eaton Racks. 17.298. That's an order to accept the donation of Eaton Rack uninterrupted power source units with a value of $20,000, a gift from Smith College.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion, further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. So that passes in first reading. Now, item 17.267 is an order to authorize payment for a prior year bill for veteran services, second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please, Pam.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
All right, that passes in second reading. We have item 17.268. That's an order authorizing senior services to accept gifts of $5,000 or less, a second reading.
To approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nell?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. Item 17.268, an order authorizing the appropriation of $1,465,692 from free cash for central services, OPS, IT, SD, fire rescue, school, and DPW capital projects.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Also in second reading is item 17.270. That's an order to appropriate $770,000 from capital stabilization for school and public safety projects.
Move
through.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion. Roll call, Pam.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
All right, that passes in second reading. Next item, we have item 17.271. That's an order to authorize appropriation of $517,000 from receipts reserved for appropriation. This is parking for capital projects.
Move to approve.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 17.272, this is an order to authorize the borrowing of $1,630,000 for the cost of engineering and construction of spillway repairs at Ryan Reservoir. Second.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 17.273, it's an order to authorize the borrowing of $250,000 for the cost of repairs to the Audubon Road water tank.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded for second reading. Discussion on this item. Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. 17.274 is an order to authorize a borrowing of $250,000 for rehabilitation and replacement of the city's primary water main transmission lines. The second reading.
To approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yep.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 17.275 is an order to authorize the appropriation from the Water Enterprise Stabilization Fund for the various water departmental department capital program expenditures. Second.
To approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. That passes in second reading. Item 17.276 is an order to authorize borrowing of $500,000 for street resurfacing. Motion second approved. Reading.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion?
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 17.277, an order to authorize borrowing of $755,000 to purchase vehicles for the Department of Public Works. A second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 17.278, that's an order to authorize borrowing of $375,000 for the Clement Street Bridge Project. Second.
To approve.
Second.
Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. Item 17.279, it's an order to authorize appropriation from the mayor's payment in lieu of taxes program to fund for cardiac monitors for the fire rescue department. Second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge? Yes. Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 17.280, that's an order to authorize the appropriation of $35,200 to fund the purchase of wide area network switches for the fiber city's fiber loop. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please, Pam.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 17.281, that's an order to authorize appropriation of $10,000 from a gift fund to be used for playground equipment at Leeds and Bridge Streets Elementary School. Second.
To approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Aye. Passes in second reading. Item 17.282, that's an order to authorize the borrowing of $400,000 for window replacement at Forbes Library. Second.
To approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion further?
Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 17.283, that's an order to authorize borrowing of $200,000 for the cost of an HVAC system installation and improvements at Forbes Library. Since made, seconded. Discussion?
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
That passes in second. Last financial order is item 17.284. It's an order to authorize reprogramming of $10,738 to partially fund fire alarm and smoke detector system upgrades at the Forbes Library.
To approve.
This is second reading. Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Take it away, Pam.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Now we come into orders, and these are also
a point of order.
Yes.
Maybe you saw it too. I think we may have missed the resolution adopting the capital improvement plan.
Yes. That was my point.
Is that what you were noting?
Yes, you're right. We didn't. We didn't.
Eagerness to take a recess.
No.
You did miss it.
Oh, yeah. No, we didn't.
Why don't we just say it was missed?
It was I missed.
Instead of.
No, I'll own that.
It was missed.
It was missed.
Under resolution.
It was barely missed.
It's the last one.
This is the last one. Yeah, no, okay. Item 17.266, it's a resolution to adopt the FY18 to FY22 capital improvement program, second reading. Kind of important.
Approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on that? Okay. Roll call.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
My machine's gone crazy. No, I'm going to beat this thing. This thing's going to... Okay, so we're back on the orders. Great. On to paper. The first order up is item 17.264. This is to establish water sewer rates for FY 2018. This is second reading.
Move to approve.
Motion's made.
Second.
And seconded. Any further discussion on this? No? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading also. In second reading is item 17.285. That's an order to authorize the mayor to convey 91 Grove Street property to ServiceNet Incorporated.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion?
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes. I'm sorry.
You're not Councilor.
You're not yet.
Councilor.
We're almost there. We're almost there.
Can you give me a...
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay. Councilor O'Donnell says yes.
I murmured yes.
Okay.
Yes. Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
There you go.
Carney?
Yes.
Jump the gun.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
All set. Okay. We're going to make this, I swear. We're almost there. So that passes in the second reading. Item, and now we're in ordinances. Item 17.250. It's an ordinance to add a new smart overlay district. City Council to consider replacement document for referral to the Committee on Legislative Matters and the Planning Board. So this is an item to refer.
Move to refer.
Second.
There we go.
So I just want to point out that maybe Councilor O'Donnell can explain this a little bit better. This ordinance is actually coming back from the Committee on Legislative Matters.
Well, there's a significant change.
Yeah, just to know, because to the Legislative Matters folks, this is returning to us. So on, as I mentioned, May 8th,
going to do the public hearing over again with the planning board because the state has decided what they're going to do now, so we're going to reflect on it again based on what the state decided to do. So we've done it once, now we're going to revisit it, and Carolyn will be here again to go over that.
You're on?
Yeah, okay, I'm a little confused because we may actually be reintroducing entirely a newly modified piece of legislation. Yes, okay.
Based on changes above and beyond our control.
Yes, well, actually, there's been a development since we first introduced the bill where we actually now want to expand the smart growth district at Village Hill. So rather than do two separate public
hearings.
That's
what this would do, yeah.
Exactly, so we're going to, okay, good. Just want to clarify.
Yep.
Okay.
So we're going to do it again.
Okay.
And I just want to clarify, too, that on May 8th, although Carolyn Misch, the senior land use planner, will be there, it won't be a joint public hearing with the planning board. It's just us.
Just us? Planning board?
Okay, so it's still for referral, and Councilor Dunn.
Only because I know it's on referral, but there's nothing else to tack this onto. But it is somewhat confusing because then what happened to the original ordinance? Do we need to dispose of it in some way, or do we just kind of pretend it didn't exist? I mean, it's not on the agenda tonight. So
my intent had been to withdraw it.
Yeah,
as the sponsor of it, to withdraw it.
Okay.
So it can be withdrawn. You can
fill it.
Table it indefinitely, whatever mechanism you want, but the idea was we wanted to pull the original and replace it with a new version.
So the sponsor wants to withdraw the original, so at the request of the sponsor, without objection.
Is it the same ID number?
Would it have the same ID number?
I did give it the same ID number,
okay.
And indicated. You have to vote to replace it. It is on the agenda to vote to replace.
Okay, then.
It's on our agenda tonight?
Yeah.
To vote to replace it.
If the City Council votes to replace the previous document,
and then refer
that came
the new
out
one.
Of the Planning Board and the City Council Committee on Legislative Matters, so the public hearing will be held on May 8th.
So can this motion to refer be understood as a simultaneous motion to replace it?
It's repeal and replace.
Yeah, I knew that was coming.
Repeal and replace, Councilor Bidwell said. So.
Repeal, replace, and refer.
And refer.
Repeal, replace, and refer.
Exactly.
Without objection, is the committee okay with that? Essentially, that we would be removing the original document and replacing it with something yet to come. And
it's come. It's here.
It's yeah. There. It's attached.
So this is the language that. This is the final language? I understood that.
Yes.
That's my understanding.
Okay.
I believe Carolyn got it to you before she left.
Got it. Okay. All right. So everyone's comfortable with that?
Yes.
Okay. So as amended on the item to refer, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? All right. Item 17.289, this is an ordinance relative to expanding permit time limits in Section 350-4.7 and 156-6B, match recently amended enabling legislation, Mass General Law, Chapter 40A, Section 9, the Municipal Modernization Act, and have this referred to Planning Board and the Committee on Legislative Matters.
To refer.
Second.
In second. Discussion on this. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 You'd be pleased to know I have no updates. And are there any committee chairs that want to share anything? No. No information requests. Then what I will accept is
to adjourn.
That's exactly what I would accept. All those in favor of adjourn,
aye.
Please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Thank you all very much.
Hey.
That's it for April.